Hello, I'm Pete Brosnan with Hollywood Locations. I recently caught up with Jim Mccabe, one of the most well-known location managers in Hollywood, at the beautiful Bel-Air Bay Club in Pacific Palisades. During the event that celebrated the four-year anniversary of the Location Managers Guild of America, it was a pleasure to sit and chat with Jim.
I walked into the office. He didn't know it was me. And he said, "You'll do fine." I go, "What?" And he said, "We have to replace the location manager on Charlie's Angels." Well, 30 years ago, and I'm single, and I'm location manager on Charlie's Angels.
Nice gig.
And he said, "You'll do fine." And he opened up his desk drawer, and he took out an envelope and kind of dropped it on the desk. And he said, "We're going to open the season in St. Thomas. Go down there and look at it."
Well, thank you, Charlie. And if you ever put forth a championship effort at anything, you be sure to let me know so I can send you a trophy.
Not a bad idea, Sabrina. I'll start working on it right away.
But then the fellow I replaced, I walked into his office, and it was Mike Jarvis, a wonderful guy.
Jarvis, I remember, says, Mike, yeah.
"By the way, you got to go down and join the union." And I said, "Okay." And it was, you know, I state your name, and you're in a union. Nobody knew what was going on. Nobody had any clues. There was no formal, you know, there wasn't anything. You just showed up and you did your job. There was an old timer named Cass Martin, who was the location manager when I came on. And everybody came out of different. Nobody ever starts out to be a location manager.
No, you fall into it.
No one ever
comes
out.
Some other way, yes.
Right. Cass was an actor, had been in Spain, kind of knocked around, did all this stuff. And he was doing locations. And I think he was working for Columbia. On location shows, it just really took off. They had a thing where they gave self-carboning checks with the amount of $2,000 in them. And they'd go on the street, no planning, they just said, "We're going out here," and they'd pull up and they go, "Okay, Mannix is gonna chase somebody through the yard." And they go knock on the door and they say, "We wanna run through your backyard, or we wanna shoot in your house." And no agreements, no signatures, no nothing, just
really?
Give them a check.
It was all in a handshake. Wow.
Handshake and a self-carboning check. The location agreement was pretty much the same all over the industry. It's, you know, "We're going to shoot here." It was before the attorneys and the risk management
had gotten into it.
Got into it and got crazy about it. And from then on, I just never looked back. The phone calls just kept coming. And, you know, it was the A-Team, and it was Cagney and Lacey. And some. So my earlier days were primarily television. And I got and just kind of gravitated over to features.
Still wanted by the government, they survive as soldiers of fortune. If you have a problem, if no one else can help, and if you can find them, maybe you can hire the A-Team.
What do you see as the biggest difference when you do locations for TV as opposed to features?
You know, first of all, in terms of the skills involved in a job, if you have a location manager who's competent in doing television, they can do anything. Because you're living by your wits, you're living by the seat of your pants. Features, you just have more time to panic. What happens at the end of the day? You still don't know where you're going to be tomorrow. You're never 100% sure of it because of the vagaries of actors' availability, scheduling, everything else. You can still wind up in a world of hurt. You just have more time to plan for it.
One of the first big jobs we did was Speed.
Yes.
And that was a biggie.
That was a wonderful show.
We had some fun on that one with the stunts on top of the gas company tower and pulling the window washing rig down.
You did the elevator, you did all the stuff that was the opening of that show, and it was just a great experience. I had the good luck of working with a producer named Ian Bryce, and I did 5 movies with him. And we took over a street from Man's Chinese, which was where we had the subway come down, explode out of the subway and on Hollywood Boulevard, and we shut it down for a day. We shut the center of it down for a week.
What about that great story? You did Rising Sun, correct?
Right.
What about that great story? I heard you had to do some kind of interesting negotiation to get one of the buildings to play ball with you, or somewhere where you had a hero location.
Two, actually. One was the building. I was brought into Rising Sun. When I came on board, Dean Tavalaris was production designer. They had begun to build, for the time, a very elaborate $2 million set at Fox that was supposed to be the top of the towers. Well, at the time, the building didn't want, all of a sudden, when they finally got around to approaching the building, they said they didn't want any part of us. So it became my job to try and get the building secured to film it.
Step aside and have no trouble. This is police business. Seems like nobody's listening.
One of the problems they had with the building, it was that the Japanese general counsel and the bank, and a big Japanese bank, were going to be anchor tenants in the building. They were afraid of offending the Japanese because of the nature of the book, which talked about the Japanese bio. So I had a meeting, because the building itself was part of community redevelopment in Los Angeles. The head of community redevelopment, who had been a former deputy mayor, set up a meeting with the president of the corporation that owned the building. And I went in, people didn't know me at Fox, I walked in with a handful of vice presidents, and the head of CRA said, "Why, you just come in." So I walked in the door for this face-to-face with this fellow. Said, "You know, it'd be interesting if I'd really like to have Sean Connery play golf with me." So he was a member at LA Country Club, this fellow was. And I approached, Connery was executive producer on the show. We approached him and we asked him if he'd do it. He went and played golf with the fellow. The following day, I saw Sean Connery on a lot of Fox, and I said, "How did it go?" And he went, "Purgatory." And I went, "Oh my God, what do you mean?" And he said, "I lost $50.
What is the most amazing feat that you've pulled off? Through ingenuity, through creative negotiation, what could you tell us, if you had to think back, was the most amazing thing you ever pulled off? You
know, the day in and day out, to go in with what I've always felt to be imagination and integrity, and you're always fighting a budget, you're always fighting a schedule. But to say after 40 years that I can go back to almost any place I've ever worked in 40 years, and I'm welcome back in, and companies are welcome back. I mean, we're still making movies in this town, bringing our factory into people's homes and neighborhoods after almost 100 years. And I think it's a tribute to the people in the business that just slug it out day in and day out and pull these rabbits out of the hat every day. And I think that's as amazing as the great big scene stealing things are. I really like what I do. In parting, I'll say I had the great opportunity to do a number of projects with one of the very dearest production designers in the business, a fellow named Dick Silbert, who won two Oscars, and one of the giants of the business, designed Rosemary's Baby, designed Chinatown. Designed Dick Tracy. The highest compliment I think in my career was ever paid to me by Dick. And one day he looked at me and he said, "You know what?" He said, "You're like me. We both enjoy what we do for a living. And I've always enjoyed every day of it." Well, almost every day.
This has been Pete Brosnan with another HLC production. Remember, Hollywood Locations is the premier provider of film locations in Los Angeles. For more information, visit HollywoodLocations.com.